All right, so let's begin. To begin, could you just please state your full name?
Pierre Gratton,
and
President and CEO of the Mining Association of Canada.
And your age, please.
My age? That's a secret.
No. Yeah?
51.
You're one of the young ones for this project, so don't worry about it. And where were you born?
I was born in Montreal.
Yeah. And what did your parents do for a living when you were a child?
Well, my mom, when I was growing up, was at home. With my brother and me, and my dad worked for Bell Canada.
Okay. And what did you do as a child, as pastimes? What was your interests, your main interests?
Well, I wasn't very sporty, though I did ski and swim. But I was, what did I do? I liked to travel, still like to travel, like biking. I went on bike trips when I was a teenager. Always sort of been a reader. Always a bit bookish, good at school.
What were your best subjects at school or favorite subjects?
My favorite subjects were always political science, history, economics, those, the social sciences were always my strength. So I came to mining not the normal route through like geology or engineering.
Yeah, yeah. Not the pure sciences.
No, that's right.
So, what was your what was going to be your idea going forward after high school? Did you know kind of what you wanted to do in life, or?
No, in fact, be honest, my career has been has just kind of happened. I mean, at one point, I thought because of my interest in political science, I might go on and study law. But then when the time came and I was in university and I finished my undergraduate, I didn't really feel like going to law school, so I did a master's. And
in poli sci
as well. Yeah, my undergraduate was in political science and economics at McGill, and then I went and did a master's as well. After I graduated, with my master's, I knew I had to get a job somewhere. And figured coming to Ottawa might be not a bad idea. It was actually in the middle of a pretty significant recession in Canada, and Montreal was especially hard hit, double-digit unemployment. Youth unemployment was really high. So I came to Ottawa thinking maybe I could get something, and ended up starting my career working for a member of parliament. And then from there, it just sort of, you know, one job led to another job, which led to another. And if you'd asked me when I graduated if I thought I'd work in the mining industry, I'd have looked at you funny. And I would never have predicted this career path for me. But it happened, and I've loved it, and I've certainly never regretted it.
So how did you fall into the, I guess, what was your first official job you considered to be in the mining sector, and how did you start that job?
Well, the closest I came was working on Parliament Hill for the minister, then Minister of Natural Resources, Anne McClellan under the government of Jean Chrétien. And at the time, I like a lot of things. I had a colleague in her office. Dan Piskowski, and he was her director of policy for mining and forestry. He had the right background. He had a master's in mineral economics. And after the 97 election, he got a job with MAC. And I stayed on with Anne McClellan after the 97 election when she became Minister of Justice. But after about 2 years, Dan called me and said, look, there's a job here at MAC, Vice President of Public Affairs and Communications, why don't you apply? And so I thought, well, okay, why not? Knew I didn't know much about mining, but also knew they weren't looking for that expertise per se. They were looking for someone with more of an understanding of how government works, how to work with media, and how to communicate, and I had those skills.
Mm-hmm.
So I applied, and they hired me. And then I discovered an industry that I found absolutely fascinating, with great people in it, really committed to what they do. And a sector that, with people who are far from, you know, some of the stereotypes you might think of when you think of mining. And I've, consequently, I'm, you know, what is it now? 17 years later, I'm still here.
Yeah.
Still in the sector.
So you started, you'd say officially, your first job in the field was Vice President of Communications.
And yeah, I was Vice President of Public Affairs and Communications for Mac. Started in 1999, worked till 2008 when I got when I was hired to be the President and CEO of the Mining Association of British Columbia. So my family and I moved out west to Vancouver
and
had three wonderful years. Best place I've lived.
Oh yeah.
No offense to Montreal, second best place.
Or Ottawa.
Third, fourth. I just had a wonderful time. What I really liked about working there, especially, was the industry was all around me, on Howe Street and around. So it was great to sort of be next door to everybody, and really felt had your finger on the pulse of the sector. But after 3 years, my former boss at Mac retired, and they came calling and said, "Would you come back?" And I wasn't sure I wanted to. I was enjoying Vancouver so much for those reasons I just gave you, but ultimately decided, yeah, I suppose I should, and came back to head up the National Association.
Okay.
In 2011, and I've been here ever since.
Now, being the president, could you explain what the role of MAC is, the Mining Association of Canada? On what you guys do maybe on a daily basis.
So we're the national voice of the mining industry, Canada's mining industry. We represent companies that operate mines from coast to coast to coast, wide range of commodities, including everything from base and precious metals to uranium, to oil from the oil sands, diamonds, iron ore. And we're the voice of the mining sector, as opposed to the PDAC, which represents the exploration community. We really focus on mining. And our primary role is to interface with the federal government on public policy. So any rules, laws, regulations, policies that affect mining, we would be the advocate for mining's perspective on those issues. So that's our primary function. It's been what we've been doing since 1935, when we were first founded. The role of the federal government has expanded. Its role in mining has expanded considerably over the years, much more so today than when MAC was first created. So there's a lot more for us to do. Our mandate has evolved in recent years to include being the voice for Canadian mining abroad to a degree. Ours is a very outward-looking sector. It's probably the only sector of the Canadian economy where you can say that we're a global leader, not sort of a branch plant of some foreign multinational. So Canadian mining is a known commodity in the rest of the world. Second largest outward investor to the banks, really a uniquely Canadian success story. So we've become increasingly the voice of that leadership in outside Canada, just in the last number of years.
And it's because mining has become so global, so international. Does MAC see itself often now dealing with other governments, or it's still strictly with the Canadian federal government?
Yeah, we'll only deal directly with the federal government per se, but other governments often come to us to learn about what it is that we do, particularly in our role around sustainable development and the work that we've done to develop towards sustainable mining. That generates quite a bit of interest. from other parts of the world. But we'll be involved as well in promoting Canada's trade ties with other countries, particularly countries where there's a strong mining interest. Lots of Latin America, parts of Africa, Southeast Asia. We are strong supporters of free trade, and also, you know, have a strong interest in ensuring our investments are protected and safe. So foreign investment protection agreements, another instrument that the federal government negotiates with other countries, are important to us. So the investments, because mines are very capital intensive. You're putting a lot of people's money at risk, and so you want to try to minimize that risk if you can, mm-hmm. from, you know, unfair government action.
Does MAC have a difficult position in the sense that it's often feel like it's running after the government to be heard, or does the government really understand the role of MAC to get to, I guess, the rest of the industry?
Oh yeah, no, I think we're definitely recognized as the national voice. The government in many ways relies on us for our views on issues, and will come to us.
Both ways.
It is. In fact, you know, there's a couple of times one of the subsectors of mining that we don't represent and haven't ever represented is thermal coal. So there's a Coal Association of Canada based in Calgary, and so we actually don't get involved in matters that affect thermal coal, whether it's power generation or other types of issues that just our members don't have an interest in. And so when those things come up, I know that the government of Canada can find it quite challenging, because they want to come to us, and we can't help them. And so they've had to, and the Coal Association itself is very small and doesn't really have the kind of public policy depth that we bring to the table.
Okay. Now, since you've worked in this industry, have you, is there any role or project that you worked on that you believe was quite dysfunctional? Didn't run the way it should have? If there is one.
Yeah, you know, I can't really think of... I'd have to go way, way back to when I first started at MAC. There was a program originally called Keep Mining in Canada, then morphed into Mining Works for Canada. And there are elements of that program still alive and well today. We've been organizing a an annual lobby day called Mining Day on the Hill every November. And representatives from our board of directors and other company reps come to town, and they meet with officials and politicians, political staff, other stakeholders over the course of a day. They can have 60, 70 meetings speaking about issues that matter to the mining industry. So we've been doing that. We were the first group actually in Ottawa to organize such an event. Now everybody does them, these annual lobby days, as they're called. But we were the first. And it was a key part of a program called Mining Works for Canada. And when I first joined the association, what I found was that Mining Works was very unfocused. It was quite superficial. It was promoting sort of mining at a very high level, but without giving what government actually needs, which is real information on the issues and our perspective on the issues. And so we weren't really getting much traction with people. We'd been doing it for, you know, approaching 10 years, and it had run out of value, we felt, that was certainly my assessment. And it was starting to also engage in other activities that were also, in my assessment, of limited value, different types of events across the country, but that weren't really targeted, no sense of a targeted audience. They were just sort of feel-good activities that cost a lot of money but didn't actually do much. And so certainly for the first few years, part of my challenge was to turn that around and focus it and reshape it. And of course, whenever you try to do something like that that's been around for a while, there are people who are attached to that model, and it can be a bit of a struggle. But ultimately, we did succeed, and I know at the time, the board itself wanted that change. So they were looking to the association to turn it around, and I think one of the reasons I was hired is they hoped that I had those skills to do that. So I knew I had the board support and my president's support to do that, but there were still people that you had to work with to convince them that that was the way to go. So I would say it was, in the early days, frustrating and dysfunctional because we were trying to obviously accomplish a critical objective, which was to advance the interests of the mining industry in Canada with key decision makers, and we weren't doing it very well, and we need to improve how we did it. And it was frustrating to see where we were at, but then also very rewarding when we were able to turn it around.
Okay. And now, since becoming president and CEO of MAC, have there been any major projects or initiatives or changes that would be worth mentioning?
Well, one of my other major assignments when I first joined MAC was to develop what became Towards Sustainable Mining, or TSM, which is sort of another central sort of pillar now of of what we do. So when we described earlier what's our function, the voice of mining, the interface with the federal government. But there's another key aspect today, which is to actively work with our members to promote sustainability in mining. And we've developed this program that is one of a kind. There isn't another country in the world, except now for Finland, that has a program like this. And I mentioned Finland because just last November, the Finnish Mining Association decided to adopt MAC's Towards Sustainable Mining initiative. And so now it's in place in a second country. And that decision has also triggered the interest of a lot of other countries, and we're now sort of getting deluged with requests from different chambers of mines and different governments around the world wanting to know what is it that we've designed and implemented here, and wondering what's involved in doing the same. So that's been something that's really exciting to watch something that I was involved in very early on in setting up, and then see it grow and actually then go global and continue to sort of spread. Mm-hmm. It's certainly a well-respected program. And as I said, there isn't anything quite like it anywhere else. It's got, there's public accountability for performance, third-party assurance. We have a national advisory panel of stakeholders that sort of keeps our feet to the fire and challenges us.
Yeah, I was going to ask. And you must be dealing with stakeholders.
Yeah, it's a pretty unique way of engaging with civil society that the mining industry in other countries haven't quite done to the extent we have. So it's something we're certainly proud of.
And is it what are the outlines of the program? Is it things that you kind of have to implement towards the industry?
So
and tell them these are so these how are things
it
you have to do
so with? How it works is every member of MAC every year at the mine site level or at the level of or smelter or refinery, because we also represent smelting and refining. They will evaluate their performance against a suite of 23 indicators that cover issues like greenhouse gas management and energy, tailings management, biodiversity conservation, external engagement, Aboriginal engagement, those sorts of issues. They'll measure themselves against criteria and give themselves a rating every year that's publicly reported. And every third year, those mine sites undergo an external evaluation of their performance, and those results are published. And then the National Advisory Panel every year will choose a couple of companies to come before them and present the results and have to speak to the results, defend the results, show how they plan to improve over time, etc. So it's fully transparent. It's available in French, English, and Spanish. It comes with training for the program as a whole, but also on some of the specific areas that have been developed. And what makes it unique is there isn't another program out there that is measuring performance at the site level. You'll have a lot of public reporting in our sector or in other sectors that are sort of company-wide, sort of a corporate roll-up. But as we know, if you're being honest, any mining company will tell you they have some mines that operate better than others. And so you can hide your overall performance, your weaker performance and highlight your stronger performers. And this program essentially compels you to be totally honest and transparent about your strengths and weaknesses, because you report on all your mines. But then what that does too is it provides a very strong incentive for the mines to improve their performance. And we're able to show, after over 10 years of doing this, significant improvements in performance across all of the indicators. Our companies are much better today at what they do than they were a decade ago, and TSM is partly responsible for that.
And what are the examples you see? You could give concrete examples of what companies were or were not doing 10, 20 years ago compared to today.
One of the obvious areas is around community and Aboriginal engagement. Today, in Canada, our sector is seen as in the vanguard of Aboriginal inclusion compared to other sectors. It's not to say we don't at times have difficult relationships sometimes with some Aboriginal communities or some companies. But for the most part, the industry is now regarded as a leader in this area. And there's a lot of interest amongst Aboriginal groups in terms of getting involved in mining, and they are getting increasingly involved in mining. But if I go back 10, 15 years, this was still pretty scary stuff for the sector. Some were doing it, but a lot were not sure how. I remember developing TSM early on, and there was a fair bit of pushback from some of the more established mine sites, saying, well, it's easier to do this if you're developing a new project to engage with local communities, but we've been in Sudbury for 70, 80 years or whatever it is, or we've been in Timmins or we've been in Kamloops or wherever it may be. You can't expect us to, repair a relationship or start a relationship now. But fast forward to today, and they all have. They now all have agreements with local First Nations, and the involvement of First Nations in the mining industry in Sudbury is like it's never been before.
And the employment, too.
And the employment. We're the largest employer. So things have really, really turned around. And I think it reflects well on the industry, and other countries around the world look at Canada and again see us as leaders in this area. So that's, one obvious one. Canada is also known for its leadership in tailings management. We're also known, we've also made a lot of progress in recent years around in terms of energy use and energy efficiency. And the most, our standards and our set of indicators dealing with energy are really equivalent to ISO 50001. They're quite compatible. And most of our members now essentially are achieving ISO 50001. So it's pretty impressive what members have been able to do over the last decade.
Different question, but furthering, I guess, more the social aspect of things. Women, how absent or present have women been throughout your career? And have you seen that change? And if so, how?
Well, here at Mac, it's always been close to 50% female from the very beginning, and half of the vice presidents were and still are female. Half of this office is female or more. I have to count now. I think it's 7 and 5. Female to male. So certainly in terms of what we do, there's always been strong representation of women. Since I became president, we've had our first female chair of the association, and next year we'll have our second female chair. We actually have a good record of now alternating. I don't know if we'll be able to continue doing that. Our board has a lot more women on it than it did when I first joined. When I first joined, I don't know if there were any, and now there's quite a large number, but they still represent the minority, and so there's still a ways to go. I've certainly seen a significant increase in the number of women I work with in this industry. I started to notice it more in geology, but I'm seeing it sort of across the board now. So it is a sector, and we have the data to show it. I mean, it is, it's still a long way from, from a 50-50 split. And, some may question whether we'll get there. Given the nature of the industry, will it attract enough women to get us to 50-50? I don't know. The more and more technology is used, probably the more and more likely that's going to be. It's not as focused on heavy equipment, and you'll often hear that some of the best truck drivers in this industry are women, because they take better care of equipment than men do, drive more safely.
I've heard it a few times.
So there is a breaking down of stereotypes within the sector occurring now. How far it will go remains to be seen, but I think there's certainly potential for it to go a lot further than it has. I'm encouraged by the change that I'm seeing and that the data is showing, but we still have a ways to go. Compared to some of the other sectors in the natural resources area, we're not doing so badly either. Energy is better than we are, but we're better than forestry, better than fishing, better than agriculture, or some types of agriculture. So we're not bad, but we've got a ways to go.
Interesting to see what you think of the situation, working, I guess, between government and industry. And the question is, do you believe there's a disconnect between the industry, the mining metallurgy industry, and the general public? And I guess we could include maybe government in that.
Yeah, I think every sector of the Canadian economy probably thinks that to a degree, especially some of the more traditional sectors, whether it be natural resources or manufacturing. They often feel that they're not appreciated enough, they're not respected enough. I take a somewhat different view. I think the reality today is our societies are now so sophisticated, information is so available, that people's attention span for anything is limited. And it would, we're kidding ourselves if we think that your average Torontonian is going to think about mining much of their day. Just like I don't think, spend much of my day thinking about the pharmaceutical sector or the telecommunications sector, unless I'm getting pissed off with my one of my devices, my cell phone, or if I'm, you know, having to get a prescription drug from the drugstore. I don't really think about other sectors of the economy the way I think about mining because I work in the mining field. But if you ask me generally what I think about the value of those different sectors, my general view would be positive, with some reservations about certain things I may have read or heard. Mm-hmm. And what we found over the last 5 years of opinion polling, which we've been doing,
From the public?
Or? Yeah, from the general public, is that Canadians' views of mining are kind of similar to what I've just described, that actually a large majority of Canadians have a favorable impression of mining. I think the range we've asked, you know, the sort of the top line question is, do you have a favorable or very favorable view of mining, or unfavorable or somewhat favorable? And the favorable and very favorable has always been somewhere between as low as 73% or as high as 84%. Those are good numbers. Our pollster, who's one of Canada's top pollsters, Bruce Anderson, you may have seen him on when he used to be on the At Issue panel with Peter Mansbridge. And he would say for a natural resources sector, you're never going to get better than 85%, because there's always going to be sort of 15% of society that doesn't believe in natural resources, would like to live in a world where we don't disturb the land, where we leave everything intact, however realistic that may, or unrealistic that may be. So there's always going to be a cohort that sort of oppose you from a certain sort of more of the extreme of views in society. So if 85 is sort of the top we can get, and in 1 year we got 84, we're doing very well. And what the results also show is they have is like I just said before about the other sectors. They know that mining has its impacts. You can't build a mine without disturbing land, without potentially having an effect on water, on wildlife. So there are environmental impacts. It can be disruptive to a community if you're nearby. But on balance, the benefits far outweigh the costs in the vast majority of cases. So their views of mining are actually quite favorable. Do they think about us regularly? No. Are they likely to? No. But when asked, they'll actually say, yeah, it's an important sector, and it's good that Canada has a strong mining industry. And they actually think governments should be doing more to support the mining sector than they currently are. So it's not a bad place to be. It was a surprise for our board and for our members to see these results when we first...
Because
most people kind of assume, and this is sort of another takeaway for us, was you're inclined to follow the clippings. And the media tend to cover controversies, and so you think that what you're reading is representative of the broader public attitudes, but it's not.
Yeah, things that go well are not as sexy.
No, that's right. Right? That's right.
Of course, yeah. Absolutely. Well, thank you. The next question is it's more of a mouthful. So, and that's in your opinion. So in your opinion, are there any events, people, inventions, contributions, disasters, anything whatsoever you believe must be mentioned when discussing the history of the natural resources in Canada?
Well,
there's no wrong answer.
Yeah. Well, I think in recent history, and if you look at the work that we do, you you have to mention some of the tailings failures we've had. The Mount Poly failure last year. Samarco in Brazil, though, you know, not Canadian, and not Canadian companies, was horrific, horrible disaster. But there were a number of sort of high-profile tailings failures in the 1990s by Canadian companies abroad. Omai in Guyana, operated by Cambior. Marcopper by Placer Dome. Two companies that no longer exist. And one could say that the contributing factor was perhaps those tailings failures. Contributing factor to their disappearance, eventual disappearance. Because those have such a devastating impact on a company's reputation and their bottom line. But it's in response to those that we developed at MAC what are now sort of international leading guidance on tailings management, and hotwired that into our Towards Sustainable Mining initiative. So we've taken sort of the crisis of tailings failures and turned it into a strength in terms of Canadian mining, where we're now seen as leaders in this area. So it's, you know, it's, I, you know, learned from some of my mentors years ago, never waste a crisis. And I think the industry did not waste the crises of seeing some of these major installations fail on them. They took them seriously. They looked at what was wrong, and they've worked really hard to try to make sure they don't happen again.
Thank you. We'll just close with a few questions. First being, what are you proudest of in your professional career?
Probably the development towards sustainable mining. That's been, I think people would expect me to say that. I'm kind of identified with it. It was what I did when I first joined MAC, and now it's sort of a centerpiece of what we do. And as I mentioned, now it's starting to go global. Mm-hmm. So one of the reasons why I'm still here is because I've found in this sector a group of people really committed to doing the right thing and wanting, sometimes feeling that they're not getting the respect they deserve for what they do. They're better than people may think they are, which takes us back to, I don't know if that's true or not, but there is that perception. But certainly a group of people who are committed to improving the way the industry goes about its business, and Towards Sustainable Mining stands out as a great example of that. They didn't have to do this, but they felt it was the right thing to do and did it in a way that made a lot of sense for business.
Last question, and that's if you were to speak to someone much younger, like a student, for example, what would be the most important life lesson or piece of advice you would give them looking forward? Not necessarily towards a natural resource industry, but just towards their professional life.
Well, they should do what they're interested in, whatever that may be. Life just sort of has a way of working out if you do what you like. Study what you like, be good at it. Learning how to write, to me, has always been it's always been one of my strengths professionally. It's taken me where I've gone, and I've always placed a high value on that. So I'd encourage people to read, write, learn, and enjoy doing what they do. And then the rest should work out.
Well, thank you. Do you have any other questions or comments?
Like, no, sure. It's odd now to be the one giving advice to people. Like, what happened? I feel I'm getting old.
Well, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Appreciate it.
Okay, bye.